Good evening. It's now 18 weeks since the National Union of Seamen went on strike against the shipping line P&O. The dispute is not only protracted, but complex, and it's now developed to the point where the issue is not only the future of the NUS itself, but more broadly, the role and purpose of the trade union movement in Britain. The dispute was provoked by the Channel Tunnel, a competitor which will pose a very obvious threat to P&O's ferry operation in the 90s. This prospect led the company to demand a fundamental revision of its deal with the union. According to the seamen, the company wanted the NUS to work longer hours for lower wages and with a smaller workforce. When talks with management and union broke down, the NUS went on strike, and soon afterwards called on its members elsewhere in Britain to come out in support of their colleagues at Dover. When they did so, the NUS fell foul of the law. There were writs, injunctions, and court hearings, where it was determined that this was secondary action and thus illegal. So when those men stayed out, the assets of the union were seized by the court. This sequestration meant that the NUS was not only locked out of its offices, but could barely function as a union. In our report tonight, John Taylor explores the predicament of a trade union as it struggles to win its case, both in the court and on the picket line.
Eastern Docks, Dover, 8 in the morning. The ritual confrontation between striking NUS seamen and working P&O ferry crews. But the union is under pressure from within its own ranks, with the executive forced to call off secondary picketing. McCluskie's travelled a long way since the strike began 18 weeks ago. He knows he can only stay in the fight if he abides by the law.
What do you say to those people who say the best way of getting the gloves off is to work outside the law?
You can't. You can't forever work without the law. I believe personally in the democratic process. I believe in Parliament. Even although, for all its warts, for the fact that it is legislation which is actually crippling the people of this country, whether they be oldies, pensioners, whether it be the medical health service, or indeed whether it be seafarers and trying to get their rights, I still believe in the mother of parliaments and I believe in the ballot box.
In Deal, the question of the law is just as important for the rank and file. Some of them still worry about the decision to back McCluskie.
So how do we stand with the law then? I mean, how do we feel about the law?
We should have all stayed solid all around the country and continued breaking the law. You know, if it's only our own members that we couldn't keep it going, but you've got to admit, if everything was still solid all around the country, we would now all be breaking the law.
Sweet. But you must understand, as a sensible person, that you can't beat the law.
You've got to stay on the right side of the law to get the back.
There's no way you can beat the law.
With its assets still frozen, the NUS has already paid the price for breaking the law.
NUS headquarters were shut down at the beginning of May, as were all the other union offices throughout the country, part of the sequestration order granted by the courts. The union's assets, bricks, mortar, cars and cash worth £2.8 million, have been taken away. So far, the union has paid out nearly £200,000 in fines. Add on the legal costs so far, and the bill is £500,000. The union has been rendered almost impotent, and Sam McCluskie is the latest in a growing number of union leaders battling in the courts against a number of laws designed specifically to restrict the power of trade unions.
During the Wapping dispute, Brenda Dean had to fight her battle with Rupert Murdoch within this new legal framework.
Oh, we're living in an age, you know, we had the old term militant unions. We're living in an age of militant managements. And yes, I mean, you've got a management that have got the law on their side. It is illegal to strike and at the same time retain your job. But it's equally legal for management to prevent secondary action and solidarity support. Of course they've got the cards stacked in their favour, but that doesn't mean to say that they're going to win or have won every round of this period. No, it's more difficult today, there's no doubt about that.
Striking has not achieved everything that we want for it, and some of the big industrial disputes, and even the Siemens case, has shown that all the muscle in the world has not given us victory. It's reduced rights, and the employers have taken the chance to come in, renegotiate contracts, take away the right to belong to a union, take away the right to representation, and sack you with impunity and not even pay you any of your employment benefits or rights. Given that, that doesn't happen abroad. We have to ask ourselves the question, can we secure them benefits which shows a proper balance of a framework of law that is even-handed between the parties in an industrial dispute and at the same time reduces the possibility of constantly having to go to war in strikes when clearly the benefits are not so obvious as people thought for them in the past.
A vision of a new future for industrial relations on this greenfield site in the west of England. Toshiba Plymouth makes TV sets and videos for the home market.
This factory has been the testing ground for a new approach to industrial relations in this country. That approach is embodied in this document signed between the management and the union 7 years ago. In it, both parties agree that in the event of an industrial dispute that can't be resolved, an independent arbitrator will be called in, who will find in favour of either the management or the union. There will be no compromise solutions, and the arbitrator's decision is final and binding on both parties. It's a deal that has meant strikes have gone out the window.
There's no closed shop here, but most of the 1,000-strong workforce are represented by one union, the EETPU. It's supposed to mean that on the shop floor of the future, there will be less need for confrontation.
The no strike part of it, I'm afraid, is in the distance. It's never used, it's never raised, except by people like yourself who come and ask the question. The single union, I find that instead of having a lot of time spent arguing with other unions on how we approach management, you can go directly to the management now and get the problems resolved before you have a problem on your hands.
The co-op had recommended we should not proceed at this stage with the 4.5-day week.
At monthly meetings of the company advisory board, the union now sits round the table with management. This is industrial democracy in action. They say there are no secrets at Toshiba. Even financial performances are openly discussed. And the implementation of future policy, set by head office, of course, is worked out in an atmosphere of shared common purpose.
Difficult to practice in the future, isn't it?
To date, the electricians' union has signed almost 30 no-strike, single-union agreements in similar factories. In return, managements have given up their right to manage in an arbitrary way. Des Thompson, managing director, previously worked in the motor industry and sees nothing wrong in this new approach.
I think for the last 20 years, I have been looking for a better way of running an organisation in order to maximise its overall efficiency and profitability. I believe this is the right way, and I believe that there are many, many managers in the United Kingdom who would be delighted to follow this route if their companies gave them the freedom so to do, and if they could link with progressive trade unions to achieve it.
There's pride here in the way the old us-and-them attitudes are changing. Whether that pride will survive the years when perhaps redundancies will have to be made remains to be seen. Chief exponent of the single union deal has been electricians leader Eric Hammond. His enthusiasm has brought accusations of poaching for members from other trade unionists. Nevertheless, Hammond is a man with a view of the future, which he believes other unions will soon have to face up to. The EETPU training centre in Kent, he spoke of his belief in what he calls the new realism.
Well, I think it provides the trade union movement with a crossroads. They really do now have to abandon the old ways, which haven't worked, which have provided a diminishing membership, look to the needs of the individual and the industries in which they work, look to means of settling differences other than by reaching for the strike weapon, sometimes because they've got nothing else to think of. We really do have to do some basic thinking about how we deal with the problems of industry and the attraction we have for individual members.
And what do you say to those people who still believe in retaining the right to strike, who want to fight their battles in the old way?
Well, I think that they've got to try and persuade employers that there is a better way. And I don't think they'll have much job persuading their members know already when they're involved in strikes that it's not a very profitable way of dealing with differences, and they would sooner have an individual, an independent, fair individual outside determine the difference between themselves and the employer. So it's the employers we've got to work on.
OK. Eric Hammond signs a deal with an employer that they'll have binding arbitration. I'll pose him the question. What does he do when the employer says, I'm not having that agreement, I'm not going to bind an arbitration? That's what we were faced with. What does Eric do, you know, if he's given away his ultimate weapon?
So you must retain the right to strike at all?
I would say must, to ensure that you've got enough weight to put on employers to enforce them to stand by agreements. I really believe that.
And if they don't do that?
Then you're in the same position as we are at the moment. You know, I mean, I don't see much sense in having these agreements if you cannot enforce them. And the employer just tears them up and walks away from you. What are you going to do? You've given up the weapon. You've given up your ultimate weapon. And, I mean, there are a lot of people like Jeffrey Stirling in this world, you know. It worries me. I think the new realism came about far too fast. It'd have been fine if you had a new trade union movement. You know, it's still steeped in the traditions of the past.
Hammond admits that his views don't apply across the board. McCluskie's point is one he readily concedes.
Well, most certainly I do have sympathy for Sam McCluskie. He's a good and worthy General Secretary. They haven't had the chance to develop better means of settling disputes in that industry. I mean, it takes two to tango. If the employers are not prepared to listen and to agree to new methods and to be bound by arbitration decisions, then there's not much the union can do about it except to use what it's got in front of it, which is usually a dispute.
Dover, 7:30 in the morning. McCluskie's on the picket line, but in 4.5 hours' time, he's due in the High Court, hoping to have the writ of sequestration on his union's funds lifted, hoping to fight another day.
Morning, Sam. Nice to see you. How are you?
Nice to
see you.
Great to see you. Great to see you.
What time are you in court?
12 o'clock, and I've got to see your solicitors to sign an affidavit.
Oh, yes.
So I'll go back to my old way with you.
It won't be easy for the union in court. At issue will be the size of the picket at the entrance to the Cross Channel ferry dock. P&O will use the law to keep Sam McCluskie on the ropes. They're quite happy with the 6 legal pickets on the road, but they want to see an end to the demonstrations that take place daily behind the police lines, behind the barriers.
At 12 o'clock today, we're back in the High Court. And if things go well, I'll be back down here tomorrow morning and probably have a lot more to say then than what I would say at this particular time. But I will tell you that P&O are trying to stop us having the writ of sequestration lifted because of this demonstration here. Now, I'm going to tell you, we can do things to help the police, but there's one thing I can't move away from, and I'm sure the police are listening to this. There is nothing wrong with this demonstration here, and it is a purely peaceful demonstration. And I only hope to God that the courts of Britain will see it for what it is, a peaceful demonstration of people making a protest about what's happening in their everyday life.
9 o'clock, and McCluskie is on the motorway, driving the 70 miles back to London.
What do you think P&O are after then, if they're going to pursue to that end, to say that that kind of demonstration this morning is also illegal?
I think what they're after is to get the last halfpenny worth of the law that they can possibly squeeze. And I think he's going to take Justice Michael Davis to say enough's enough. We can say enough's enough, you know, and the police and all, because we've worked very closely with the police, and we have good reports from them that they're quite happy about where those 6 pickets are and where the demonstrators are, and there's no problem. So I think it's just a case of, when Justice Michael Davis is enough's enough, rather than McCluskie's getting enough's enough.
P and O are just as determined to win this fight. At stake for them is the future of their investment. With the Channel Tunnel set to undermine everybody's profits, the company's ferry business must be in shape to face increased competition.
The company in Dover isn't earning enough money to refurbish, let alone replace the ships. It is earning less than 10% on the capital that's employed in it. It is the profitability of the company that provides jobs and secures the future. Just as sure as God made little apples, if that company is not competitively profitable, there will be no jobs in the future, and we don't intend to allow that to happen. We are going to put that company through the year 2000 successfully.
Is that with or without the unions? It doesn't matter.
Well, they are now putting the ships back to sea without the union.
London, 11:45. Sam McCluskie and the union solicitor Chris Irving on their way to the High Court. Both men are hoping things will go their way, although the solicitor has some slightly worrying news.
Yeah, well, so you reckon he'll be an adjournment?
I think so, for the picket line.
Yeah.
But I just want to see how that pans out, because apparently they're producing some photographs this morning.
Where a bit?
Of the demonstration, but we haven't seen them yet.
Yeah. How are you?
The photographs about to be produced in court will have an important role to play in the proceedings.
In court, the union's counsel argued that the demonstration at Dover was the legitimate and peaceful expression of understandable frustration felt by striking men and women. P&O, however, argued that this demonstration amounted to an unlawful inducement for working ferry crews to break their contracts through intimidation. The judge was much taken by the photographs produced by P&O in court, and let it be known that he wasn't at all impressed by the union's argument that the men and women were simply letting off steam. He said, a bus led by a police car in front of a horde of shouting people is no way for someone to go to work in this country. It became quite clear that in order for the writ of sequestration to be lifted and the union's assets to be released, the demonstration at the Dover dock would have to stop.
Well, Sam, there we are. We've got a decision to make now. Unless we remove the demonstration from Eastern Docks, we're not going to get the sequestration lifted.
Yeah, well, we've got a problem, because most of the men that's on that now are seafarers who were sacked with P&O. And it's all very well for the judge, who appears to be creating new laws, as I reckon it. You tell me if I'm wrong. So far as picketing and demonstration is concerned, it's going to be a hard job to pull them off. You know, I mean, we're fine to take a look backward steps, but we've been taking it on the jaw all the time for the courts. Now, P&O, we're the bogeyman. Not a bloody thing.
Look, I'm sick and tired of saying to you, Sam, every time we get beaten up in court, the law is against you. It's happened time after time, and it's going to happen again. That's the problem. And that's the way it is. It's getting to the point where you can barely have a strike. You can't have an effective strike anymore. That's gone.
But tell me, what if we withdraw our pickets and a bunch of guys from the other areas come in? And I'm not talking about seamen.
No.
I'm talking about guys that I have no influence over whatsoever come in and mount a picket. What's the National Union of Seamen's position then?
Well, I think that you'd be all right. The judge has just got to accept that you cannot control a whole bunch of individuals. You can ask them not to do it. You can plead with them not to do it. If it comes to, at the end of the day, it's down to them. And if they say to you, put two fingers in the air, say, we're going to be there, never mind what you say, what can you be expected to do?
Well, you know, even the Americans, as bad as their laws are, which are some of them draconian, will not stop a picket line that's on the move altogether.
No.
You know? But here they are.
Yeah.
Eh? We're that far right to the right of the Yanks, even. You know, that's how good we are with our trade union laws. I'm sorry, you know, I'm pissed off.
Sam, you've still got a decision to make. If the police won't wear any arrangement, if the judge won't allow us to have an adjournment to try, you've still got a decision to make as to whether you're going to call the picket off or not.
Men won't wear it. Their members won't wear it. Can I say the men and women won't wear it? There's women on the picket line, I know. No. I can talk to them, but I don't think they'll wear it.
But you're prepared to talk to them?
Oh, I'm always prepared to talk to the membership of the National Union of Seamen. The day I don't is the day I'm finished.
The next day, the judge found in favour of P&O. The union's funds would remain frozen until the day the demonstration was lifted. Sam McCluskie was told to rest for a week by his doctors.
Normally, when a union has its back to the wall, it turns to the TUC for help. But throughout this dispute, the men at Congress House have had their hands tied. There has been an attempt to involve the transport workers and the railmen, but that's failed because it would have taken them outside the law. The TUC hasn't been able to offer any direct financial assistance because that's illegal too. A way round that has just been found by setting up a hardship fund, and £250,000 has been paid into that. In the past, the collective might of the TUC would have been expected to influence the course of events, but not, it seems, now.
The TUC has other problems too. Its very unity is under threat. The electricians are determined to go ahead with single union, no strike deals, and there's every prospect of them leaving the TUC altogether. Now balloting its own members on the issue, the only question is whether they'll get out before they're thrown out. Either way, Eric Hammond isn't worried.
What do you think are the benefits to be had from being a member of the TUC?
Well, they're difficult to enumerate. I certainly couldn't arrive with all my members, you know, material benefits. Benefits of us being put out means that we're over £300,000 better off each year. And it's significant that our critics within the TUC, when the suggestion of us being put out is mooted, say, well, they won't dare go out because they'll be carved to ribbons outside. So nobody says to us, look, if you go out, you'll lose this benefit for your members. Your members won't have this pile of goodies or that, because there aren't any there.
The demonstration at Dover is still there in force, in spite of the court's judgment. Sam McCluskie is back and in discussion with his lawyers. The union is still on the ropes.